Hello, in this video we will be developing Missile Command. Missile Command is a game from the 1980s. It's made by the game company Atari back in the days. In Missile Command you are a defense system that has to shoot missiles from the sky. So we have missiles that come that fall down on Earth. And we have missiles that we fire or launch at these missiles that try to strike us. We play the game with the mouse. You move the mouse, the cursor moves along with the mouse. It's where you aim at, and where you aim at, you can fire it. So let's start. Let's start again with setting up the game. So step one. We have to add the content to the project and create a playing state. So I have an empty directory again, and I have the files here. So let's start with extracting the project, the solution, and next is extract content. Okay, so now I will be copying content to the projects folder content directory. There we go. Okay. Let's remove the initial extracted content folder. Next we'll be starting the solution file. The solution file, you recognize it by the SLN file. It's the Microsoft Visual Studio solution. In this solution there's a project. The project is called Missile Command. And so this solution has one project. You can also see that in the Explorer. If you open Missile Command, we can see there's a project file here. This project file has all our source code and our content. So let's open the main class. And we can see that the game window, the game world, is 800 pixels width, 600 pixels high. So you can change that accordingly, but for this game this is good. Let's continue to the next step, and that is to make sure the content is referenced. That's referenced by the content.mgcp file, and this is the MonoGame content pipeline tool. Go to the content directory, open the file. When we open the file, we can now add all these files except for the file itself. So we open it and we build. And if everything is green and the build went on to be successful, we go back to our project. We want to reload it, yes to all. And now you can see that the content as these references. So we can access these files by their name and without the extension by their name. This is how the content loader can find the files. Okay. What is the first step? The playing state. Create a class playing state which extends the right base class from the framework. Let me just increase the file size so it's better viewable in the video. Okay. So if you've made previous games, you know which one is best suited, right? So the playing state has multiple objects in it. So we want a list, a game object list. And so we can add the different missiles, etc. And the list is a data structure list that can contain these various and multiple objects. I go to the folder game state, add a new class. Playing state. And I make sure it extends game object list. I'll just copy the constructor. I change the name of the constructor and I make sure that the layer and the ID are forwarded. They are forwarded. And so if I click on base, you can see that we go to the constructor of game object list. And so this way you can see that the playing state, when a new playing state is created, the constructor is called and this constructor will call the constructor of its parent class, its base class, which is game object list. And the game object list, if you click on this base, it will call the constructor of the game object, the game object constructor. And this is the end. Okay, let's go back to the playing state and make sure it is referenced inside our game class. So we need to include the namespace, so we just mouse over, go to the light bulb with the arrow down, and we click on using missile command game state. And this way it will add the namespace to the using list. Now it can find the playing state, which it previously could not. Next is to instantiate the playing state, and we can do it like this. And the last part is to add the game state to the game state manager. So we have a game state manager, and we can add a game state. And what the game state needs is a name, and it needs a key value pair. And the key is a string name, and the value is this object, the playing state. We just call it playing state. Okay, so now we can switch to the game state by using that key, the string playing state. I'll copy it, I'll call the switch, and the switch will make sure that this is the active game state. I don't know what happened there. Copied something incorrectly. Okay, so we create the game state, we add it to the game state manager's game state list, and we switch to this game state, so it's the active game state. Now this one will be updated, drawn, etc. And in the game loop. So in game environment, you can see there is the game manager, game state manager. Game state manager has the dictionary with the key value pair. That's named game states, and it has a key value pair, and the way an item is added to the game to the dictionary is by referencing the game states. Between square brackets you enter the key, and with the assignment you add the value. So this key will reference this value inside the dictionary, and we call the game state manager to pass these key values, key and value, I should say. Let's look at the next step. Expand the game so it has a background. Okay, let's do that. Let's go to playing state, and let's add a background here. And the background can be a sprite game object. It's a static background, one sprite. So we'll just use the sprite game object and we call it background. And the background would like to have a asset name that has some default values, the layer, and you can have multiple layers, so which object is drawn on which other, on top of which other object, special ID to find it, and a sheet index, or if there's a sprite sheet, you have one texture with different parts that reference different images. And, but we just have one image, one file, one image. Okay, let's go to the content and look for the background. So this is the background. So we copy the name and paste it as a string inside the sprite game object. And we should not forget to add this background to the children's list, because only the children will be drawn and updated. So if we don't do it, we don't see a background. Yeah. I'll show you. If you start the game, there's no background because the background is not updated and drawn. The way we add the background is by adding the background reference to the sending it to the add method. The add method is a method inside game object list. Here we go, game object list, and there's an add method. It will add the object to the children and it will set the parent. And so this game object list will become the parent of our background. And the background lives inside the playing state. Now we should have a background. Good. That's a very nice background. So this is step one, and make sure to commit it to your repository. We would like to have our project under version control, and the way we can do it is by setting up a repository and adding the project to it. That can be seen in other videos. In this video, that this has already been done, and we just have to commit the step. Let's take the name of this step, go to Team Explorer, go to Changes, and say we would like to commit this. And you can double check. You can see here we have add step one. Okay. So next is the step two, create the cannon and the crosshair and make them react to the input. So we are going to create a subclass cannon. And it should extend the rotating sprite game object. Okay, so this is already a given. And then make sure the position is set at these exact coordinates. And the origin equals 16 times 16. So let's go to game objects, add class, cannon, add the cannon. Make sure it extends rotating sprite game object. Okay, so let's see if we're missing a namespace. We are missing a namespace. The namespace is called Flappy Bird, so it's copied from another project. This is not that nice, so we'll remove the namespace here. We'll just move it to the left. And now the rotating sprite game object is similar to the sprite game object or the game object list. It's just in the root of the namespace. So that's better. Now it can also find it. But what it is missing is a constructor. So let's copy this constructor and paste it in the cannon and change the name. So this is good now. Okay. And the cannon needed to be set at a certain position and have an origin. So let's do that. So the cannon has a position. This position originates from game object. Here, position. This is the member variable. This is the property. So we use the property. If there is a property, the preference goes to the property because maybe the property does something special. It can do additional mutations or changes or calculations. And the position is a new vector. So what you see happening, the vector is recognized in the framework and it copies the whole namespace. So this is valid, but this reads a little bit better. So I'll go mouse over and I'll say using the framework reference. And now we can just only instantiate it by class. So what was it? 384504? Remember, 384504, yes. And the origin 1660. Okay. this cannon. It doesn't say it in the description, but we wanted to have the cannon in the world, right? So what we can do is create a cannon in playing state. And include the namespace. Now we need a sprite, so we go look for the sprite. Cannon. What we have done now is created a cannon, instantiated the cannon, and add the cannon just like the background to the game object list. In cannon, the cannon when it is created is set at a certain position and a certain origin. So if we run the game, we see that there's a cannon, difficult to see, but there's a cannon on top of the base and it's pointing to the right. Okay. So that's that part. Now we want a crosshair. Make sure that the crosshair in the constructor, that the origin equals the center, and make sure the position is being updated each frame so it gets the location of the mouse. We didn't see the mouse in the screen. We will have a crosshair which is more meaningful in the game. So the crosshair can be a sprite game object. Just a static image, doesn't need to rotate or anything. So we can just copy the constructor from the sprite game object. And we paste it, change the name. We forward all the missing arguments. So we keep argument accessible, so from crosshair you can still set the layer, the ID, the sheet index, and we forward the asset. And we want the origin to be equal to the center, so we have two properties, one that can calculate the center, so it takes the width and the height of the sprite, and it divides it by two, this way you get the center. It makes the origin equal the center. And so the crosshair is nicely positioned at the center of the mouse. So the center of the crosshair matches the center of the mouse, the pointer of the mouse. And next is that we had to make sure the input, the position matches the location of the mouse. So what I'm looking for is the input handler. And we have handle input in this interface. So the game object list should have handle input. Here it is. And handle input is called every frame. So we extend it. So we first copy it. Then we change virtual into override. This way, the handle input is overwritten, and next we can call the base, so base dot handle input, and we forward this parameter. So the chain stays intact, so the information is forwarded also to the base. And if you now click on handle input, you see we return to the handle input inside game object. And below it, we can execute our own code, and our own code is that the position of the crosshair has to match the position of the mouse. Mouse position. There we go. So that's all there's to it. Yeah, we just added one line, and that should make it work. Ah, question for you. Why are we not seeing the crosshair? Your answer is because we didn't create and add it in the playing state. Your answer is Correct. So let's do this. Let's see what is the name of the crosshair. Oh, I think we should see it. And there we go. Oh, very nice crosshair. And this is our cannon. So done. Two steps done. Now for the third step, make sure that the cannon points at the crosshair each frame. We get a hint. Use the rotating sprite game object. It's method look at. Okay, let's look at that given look at method. Here is that method. So the description is sets the target object. So this object will always be pointing towards the target object. And we have an offset. Degrees to offset from calculated angle. Game object to look at. So we have to look at the crosshair. And nothing was said about an offset. So let's call this method and pass in the crosshair. And then the target object for the cannon will be the crosshair. So let's go to playing state. Playing state knows both cannon as well as crosshair. Cannon does not know crosshair, and crosshair does not know cannon. So we go to the one layer up, so to the parent of those objects, which is playing state. And we make sure that the communication between cannon and crosshair, or crosshair and cannon, is set here. And this should happen every frame. So we need the update method. So we copy the update method, we paste it. It's already overwritten because this object already overrides it from game object. In game object it's virtual. In playing state, or in where was I? In game object list, it's overwritten. So we don't need to change it. Once you have done override, you can keep it on override. And the game time is unknown, because it misses the namespace. So we add the namespace. And game time is also from the XNA framework, not the game framework. And we remove the for each loop. We keep the base update call. And because that was very important, this will update all the children objects. So it's very important. And what we will do here is make sure that the cannon will look at the crosshair. So we call the method on cannon and we pass in the crosshair. Let's see if this does it supposed to. Yes, and now you can see that the cannon is rotating. It's so good at it. So let's commit step two. Team Explorer, commit, and that's it. View history, and we have step one and step two. Okay, step three. Create a class missile. The missiles. So we have a cannon, we have a crosshair. Now we want some action. We need some missiles for that. So we have the missile, and it doesn't say from which object we should extend it, but the missile has a visual element to it. It has a sprite to it, so which object do you think is best for the task? And right you are if you said sprite game object. And we copy constructor, change the name. Make sure that the values are forwarded and the chain is intact. And we have to add two extra values, the start position and start velocity. So let's do this. So we add two extra methods. And you saw you also had to include the namespace for the vector too. So we add two arguments to the constructor. So now we need these three arguments to create a missile. They need to be sent to the missile. So the position needs to equal the start position, and the velocity needs to equal the start velocity. There we go. And the asset name will just be forwarded to the base. We can also add it to a new line, makes it better readable. And we have to create two game object lists in the playing state for friendly and enemy missiles. Okay, let's do that. Let's go to the playing state, to the top, and let's create these game object lists. We have friendly and enemy missiles. So part 2 complete. Part 3. Fill the enemy missiles with 50 objects of the class missile and use the data that follows here. So we have an asset name, which is the sprite.red. We have a start position, which is random. It should be random, both the x and the y. And we have a start velocity, in which the x is random, but the y is not. Okay, so let's start with a loop to create these 50 objects, because we don't want to create 50 separate objects, right? We want a loop for this. So we will do that in count is 0. So this is our missile count, we want 50, and what we also want to do is first instantiate and create a new game object list in memory. So I should do this. So enemy missiles is new game object list. So now we have new game object list. Now we go into the loop, and what we're going to do in the loop is add new missiles to our enemy list, and our missile needed 3 arguments, and these arguments are also specified here. So let's first start with a start position. So what I like to do is create a vector 2 position. Let's call it new position for the position, and it has a random value between two numbers. The random method, there's a random class available. It's in missile command game environment. It's random, so we can use it. And it's static, so we can just access it everywhere in our code by calling missile command or game environment, then accessing random. And random next has 3 methods. So this is method overloading, and they have different parameters. So depending on the parameters you pass into the next, it will execute the next method that belongs to it. So you can see there's no parameters. two integers, one integer. So if I pass in one integer, it will execute this method. If I pass in no integers or no arguments, it will execute this method. And if I pass in two integers, it will execute this method. And we need this method because we also got a minimum and a maximum value. So let's do this. And the minimum was 0, 0, 800. Okay, so that's the for the x value. Now for the y value, just copy the whole statement, minus 1000 until 10. Okay, this is a position, so this will be the start position for our missile. So it will start somewhere at the top, or the x somewhere from the left to the right, and it will start minus 1000, which is a very high upwards out of the screen, and 10 close to the inside of the screen. And 0 is top left, 0, 0, and let's see in the mix comment, 800, 600 is the bottom right. And so if you go down, you go from 0 to 600, and you go from 0 on the left to 800 on the right. Let's go back to playing state. So this is our start position. We want something similar for the velocity. So I'll just copy it and I'll change the things I want different. So we got a new velocity. Then the y was not random, it was set to 30, I think. 30. The x is minus 10, 10. So it will always go down, but in with a different angle. So more to the left or more to the right. Straight down is also possible if x is 0. And last but not least is we add these methods to our missile. So we have the position, the velocity, we just need the asset name. The asset name is a string. You can see it's a string. So we have to look for it. And it was the red dot. So I go to the content file and I'll search for the red dot. This is the green dot. This is the red dot. Okay. This should be good to go. We'll check that in a bit to see if can we already. We can almost. Let's finish it by also adding the missiles that the game object list to our other game object list. And so we add a game object list to a game object list, and this way, 50 bullets that are inside this list will also be inside the other list. And that's very important. You shouldn't forget statement, otherwise you don't see them. Here, draining missiles. Then the next part, make sure that the object of the class missile is add to the friendly missiles the moment that the player presses the left mouse button, and make sure the position equals that of the cannon, and the speed is equal to the angular direction of the cannon, and multiply that with 20. Okay, so these are quite a few instructions. Just go down through them one by one, from the top to the bottom. So first, we have to check, we have to make a missile somewhere, and we have to do that when the player presses the mouse button. So the player presses the mouse button, what method can we read that possibility? It's in the handle input method. Yeah. So let's copy it, go to playing state. Above update, I will overwrite the handle input. I will make sure to call it space. And I have to read. Read the mouse button, the left mouse button. So is mouse left button pressed or down? So when it presses it, this is a method. So if the mouse button is released in this frame, it will call that the mouse button was pressed. So let's do that, and we can shoot one bullet at a time. We have to click for each bullet. If you use the down button, it will constantly fire bullets. So that's nice to do for fun, but it doesn't make the game challenging. And make sure, so we have to add the missile to our friendly missile list. So what we'll do first is create an instance of the friendly missiles and also add the friendly missiles to the game object list. We do that in the playing state. And so we had our friendly missiles. Let's instantiate the friendly missiles game object list. And let's add this friendly missile game object list to our playing state, just like the enemy missiles. Okay. And now it says it is never used. Now that will happen now. We're gonna make it fill it up with a bullet. And what we get is something similar to the enemy missile. So we'll copy it. What we will change is first the name to dot green, because we have green bullet. And next is that the position has to be the position of the cannon. So we call the reference of the cannon. And we do dot position. So this way we get the position. And the speed was the cannon angular direction times 200. If I'm not mistaken, make sure that the speed equals the angular direction of the cannon and multiply it by 200. So that's what I've done. So we have the position, the velocity, and the sprite. And when we hit the mouse, we press the left mouse button, or when we have pressed the left mouse button, it will spawn this missile. It will add the missile to the friendly missile list. The friendly missile list is updated because it's added to the game object list called playing state. So the playing state will manage all the things that are added to it. There we go. You can see we are shooting bullets, but the bullet is spawning on top of the cannon. That's not that nice. So what we will be doing is changing the cannon and moving the cannon to the bottom. So what is add lastly will be shown mostly on top. So this will be the background. On top of the background we have the crosshair. On top of the crosshair we have enemy missiles. On top of enemy missiles we have friendly missiles, and on top of friendly missiles we have the cannon. But maybe it's also nice to add the crosshair to the top of the screen, because it's the user looking into the world and moving his crosshair around it, so that should be above everything. Here we go. You see the crosshair is above everything, and now you can also see that the bullet is spawned from behind the cannon. You can give it a little offset so it may be spawned from the top of the turret. But that's not a requirement here. It's a challenge. So feel free to take up that challenge. Let's commit step 3. Commit and check, and we can see it's that. Okay. Step 4, explosion. Of course, explosions. Create a class explosion with the right sprite. Okay, so it's a sprite game object, or I'll choose it to be a game. Whoa. Now the name is messed up. Make sure that the name is right. Okay, here we go. Explosion. Write name object. Call the constructor again. Asset name. Okay. Explosion. Make sure that it's an integer explosion duration. Okay, let's do that. The origin equals the center. Origin. Let's take the property. Origin equals the center. Visibility to false. And make sure that we add the explosion to the playing state. Okay, there we go, playing state. Explosion. And we have to also instantiate it. Instantiated below the crosshair. We add it, and we need to find the texture. Cannon's playing state. Okay, there we go. So we've done this. Now we're going to add a method detonate to explosion. This is public void detonate. Detonate needs to get a position. So a position is a position in our two dimensional world. So we want a don't call it start, but spawn position. And I think that nice, that name is fits the situation better. Make sure that the position equals the spawn position. And where are we? The explosion duration should become 60. I guess 60 frames per second. So if your game runs at 60 frames per second, it will show this explosion 1 second. So it's frame based, not time based. So if the computer runs at 30 frames per second, it will show it 2 seconds. And make sure that the visibility property equals true. And so when it detonates, it will become visible. Override the update method of the explosion, in which you change the explosion duration, you decrease it with 1. And when the value is smaller than 1, we hide it again. Okay, so we go to Sprite Game Object. We'll see if it has an update. I don't see it. I go to Game Object. I go to Update. And copy it. I'll change virtual to override. I'll make sure that this line gets called by calling the base. Forward the game time, and what we will be doing is if it's greater than 0, explosion duration -1, if explosion duration smaller than 0, smaller than or equal, right, not smaller than, we will make sure the visibility is false again. So if the explosion duration is greater than 0, so when it's set, we will decrease the explosion duration by 1 every frame, every time update is called. And as soon as the explosion duration becomes smaller than 0, we will hide this object again. And when the visibility is false, also the update will not be called anymore. And that happens inside the game object list. I'll show you. our explosion is added to the game object list. Our game object list updates our objects. And in the draw, we have here visible. So if visible is false, it returns. If visible is not false, it will draw, it will add the sprite to the sprite batch, so it should be drawn this frame. And so the visibility determines if it is drawn. The update is just called every time, even though it's not visible. And so those two things are separate. And this should be it. So I don't call the detonate yet. I do that in the next part. So we'll commit part 4. Let's do this. Save it. Check it. Good to go. Step 5. Step 5, collisions. Detect collision between all visible enemy missiles and friendly missiles. When there is a collision, make sure that the friendly missile becomes invisible and call detonate. Detonate of explosion. Make sure it happens at the right place. Okay, let's first start with the collision between the visible enemy and the invisible enemy missile. So because we have a reference in playing state to both these lists, we can do this functionality inside the playing state. So maybe there are more enemy missiles and friendly missiles. No, so let's start with the for loop. So for each missile in friendly missile, not, and we need to have the children. So friendly missiles has the children list. We can access it by its property here, and it returns the children list. And the actual list is protected inside game object list. So we can get it, we cannot set it through the variable. We have the methods add to set it, but the property can still return this list. So we get it, and we want to do the same thing for enemy. So just copy the enemy missile list. And so we have a double loop. And I'll call this enemy missile and this friendly missile. So we have fr missile and n missile. And the thing is, I only want to check it if the missile is false, visible. So if the fr missile, friendly missile, is visible, only then go through all enemy missiles, and the same with enemy missiles. If the enemy missile is visible, then do collision detection. So now we can do our collision detection, and we have our collide with method, and we can pass in another sprite game object, and it will check if these two sprite game objects overlap. If they overlap, we execute the code. So if friendly missile is visible and enemy missile is visible and they collide, then it should detonate and become invisible. I'll make it invisible. Now we'll call detonate on explosion. So explosion is what we have here, explosion, creation of explosion, and we just created that detonate method in explosion. Okay, here we go. And we need the spawn position, which is the friendly missile dot position, where the friendly missile hits the enemy missile is where the explosion happens. Okay. Then we have to check if there is a collision between the explosion and the enemy missile, because the explosion will destroy enemy missiles. So the explosion will happen, it has become visible, and then underneath this collision detection between friendly missiles and enemy missiles, we're going to do a part in which we do the collision between the explosion and the enemy missiles. So I will copy this. I will say if explosion is visible. So this is if explosion is visible, you can also say this is true. Also, it's the same, but the other one is shorter, but I'll keep this one for now. And if the explosion is visible, and if the enemy missile is visible, so here as well, you can do it like this. We would like to check for collision detection. So if now the explosion collides with an enemy missile, this enemy missile should become invisible as well. Okay. Let's try it out. We have an error. That's why we need to try it out. Okay, we miss. So it gives us these nice lines. That's very helpful, because then we know where our bracket is missing. Okay, so there we go. Fire a missile. Let's see. I hit something. And I destroyed two missiles. It should only be visible for a second. So this is not working correctly. So I'm missing something. Let's go to the explosion. We call detonate, we set the explosion duration to 60. When this one is bigger than zero, so at a certain point it's zero and it will not call this part of the code anymore. And so this is a tiny mistake, but it's a huge consequence. There we go, and now it's visible for second one. Bam, bam, bam. Good. So the collision is complete. We committed. Committed, and the last part is polish. Show a score. And the title screen. So let's start with score. Score, we get 10 points for every enemy missile, and the score that is a text. So we would like to use the text game object for this. We will extend it. So we have a class score, we extend the text game object, we go to text game object, we copy the constructor, we go back to score. Make sure the name is correct. We forward the asset name and we give it a integer score value, and we give it a property. Int score value return in the set, in the get, in the set we will make sure that the text . So we first set the score value when we assign the property. Next, we will make sure that the text is also set. So both the score as the text will change whenever we set the score value. The score value is public, so it's accessible from the outside, and the score value with a small s is a member variable, which is private. So this way, when we set the score value as 0 in the constructor, it will call this score value and it will do these two instructions. So set the score value and change the text. And now what we have to do is make sure that it is add to the playing state. So, and we'll just add it just below the crosshair. Okay. And it misses the asset name. The asset name is just sprite. Game font, sprite font. Called game font. It should be a string. Okay, the position will be 0, 0, so the top left. And there is 0. And we don't get points yet. That is what we will do next. Add 10 points for every enemy missile. So for every enemy missile, when they disappear, score value is score value plus 10. And so we add 10 points. There you go. Next is step 2, title screen state. Okay, so when that player can start the game, add the title screen to the game state, and the title screen needs to be a game object list, because we need to add the text. Okay, object list. Copy the constructor. And we will add a text. Next game object. Intro. Text intro. Text game object. This should be again the font. So we don't have a special class for this text intro, it's just text. And for score we have this special value that needs to change for text intro not. And what we would like to do is set the text so it says press the left mouse to start the game. Maybe we want a position to be the center of the screen. So we have two vector, and then we can divide it by two. So the position will become the screen. The screen is a point. We convert the point to a vector, and the vector we can divide by two, and this vector, the position is a vector, so that's why we need vector in the end. So we convert the point to a vector and we divide it by two. So you get half the screen width and height as the position for the text. So I don't think the text is positioned around its origin. So it will be a little to the left. Game object. And it doesn't have a center or anything, but that's okay. It doesn't say that it has to be in the center of the screen or anything, so keep that for, we'll save that for an additional challenge, and so figure out how you can put put this position in the center. And the game has to start when you press the left mouse button. Okay, let's first add the title screen to the game. This way we can test the functionality. Call it title state. Title state is new. Title screen state. And we will add this title screen state to the game state manager as well. And we, instead of going to the playing state, we start in the title state. So we create a member variable, we instantiate the title screen, we add the title screen to the game state manager. We switch to the title state. Okay, we see nothing. Let's go to the title screen state and we see nothing. Do you see why we don't see nothing? We don't see the text. Yes, we didn't add it to the title screen. Here we go. There it is. And you can see it's showing on the from the center of the screen, but it's not the center of the text, so it's partly out of the screen. So a simple thing is to manually change, for example, with this. Can we change that? Only the X value. We cannot change only the X value. And this is new factor 2. Let's remove this and make use of the namespace. Okay, so now we do it manually. This is not the preferred method of choice. Now I'm wondering why it didn't go to the left too much. It's going to the right. Ah, yes. And minus times minus. Well, I should, so now I do minus 200. I can do, so this is about the center of the screen. We have add our title screen, and the last part is to change the state to the game state, the playing state, when the left mouse button is pressed. And for this left mouse button, we have the handle input again, so we copy it, we go to title screen, we change virtual to override. We call the base. And we check if the left mouse button is pressed. And left mouse button pressed. If so, missile command game state manager switch to. And we want to switch to our playing state. Run the game, press the mouse button, and we're in our game. And this is missile command. And that's it. Thank you for watching. Okay, this 300 is still bothering me. So let's fix it and change it to the center of the screen. So let's go to text game object and see what we have available. So we have the text. We have size. So size measures the size of the string. So instead of doing 300, we can do the text intro dot size divided by 2. That's a property divided by 2. Now it should also be in the center. There you go. This is much better. Exactly the center. Okay, so the text game object has that property that you can use. Okay, let's run the game again, and everything's still working, and we'll shoot some missiles. Nice wavy pattern. Thank you for watching.